Prestigeon or the noble Ethiopian Abyssinian? This is part 18 of the investigation of Prestigeon. If you have not checked out the previous 17 drops, the previous over 30 hours of reading and research, look, you know, we're getting to a point where, you know, it's all right to have a couple of, you know, good, strong theories by this point. I mean, after 37 hours, I mean, Drop Nation, you've been doing this with me, so I don't do this, you know, for the masses. I do this for the few, and you know who you are. I do this for, you know what I'm saying, again, my little homeboy with his headphones on in the corner somewhere, just chilling, just getting the drop, quiet, digging on it. I do this for you and my, you know, young queens and my, you know what I'm saying? And my elders, I do it for my elders, you know what I'm saying? So we're all together, we're all connected. This is part 18. Columbus's golden world. I had to go back to where we started. I had to go back to the lost tribes and promised lands by Ronald Sanders. I had to get back in that drop library. Hope you guys are enjoying digging on it. Let's go. We're going to connect some things. You know, that should be right on time for us. So I want to go back to this because this is the part that had us, you know, puzzled, you know, from the very beginning. From the very beginning, it was like a riddle. We do not know much concerning Columbus's crew of about 90 men aboard the three ships, but at least one of them was an Israelite whose presence as such was not merely accidental. This was Luis de Torres, a convert of possibly only that year. So he had just converted. So he wasn't an Israelite, right? He was a Jewish convert who at once held a position with the governor of Mercia. He was said to have known Hebrew, Aramaic, and some Arabic, and had been brought along by Columbus specifically as an interpreter. Which gets you to the next question. Oh, well, why did Columbus know he would need a Hebrew interpreter, this convert Torres, when sailing west? What was the recon? What was the information that Columbus was going on that said, you know, I'm going that way. I need to be able to communicate with those indigenous Americans. So the best way I can communicate with them, whether I land in Hispaniola, Haiti, whether I land in the Dominica, whether I land, you know, anywhere in between, as we know, Columbus never made it to North America. But oh boy, was he looking for this India. You know, we always heard that, oh, you know, he was looking for India. Now we realize he was looking for Prestigeon of the three Indias. And this America is India. It's the third India, which we're going to recap on right quick. So he was said to have known Hebrew, this interpreter. One of the purposes of the voyage, as we have seen, was to find the Great Khan. So, I mean, that kind of baffled me from the beginning of it. Didn't, you know, see how that associated with this investigation for Prestigeon, but I mean, oh boy. So now that we know that Prestigeon is also called Wang Khan or Ong Khan, and he's called the Emperor of the Caryats of the Mongols. He's also called Lebnadengo David or King David. So we realize now that there's a whole section of Mongols that are literally Israelites. And that we're being hid under these terms like Mongol, Nestorian, all these different ways. So one of the purposes of the voyage, as we have seen, was to find the Great Khan. And Torres was to be the mouthpiece for this encounter, presumably on the basis of his Hebrew. So again, Torres was specifically coming to speak Hebrew to people in the Americas. And you think I'm crazy for saying that Peru Salam? That this is our center, that this was the old world, is the old world, that all these biblical towns are here and they are authentically originate here. Authentically. That this land here predates that land that they're saying that we come from. Columbus was coming to discover America, right? But he needed to speak Hebrew to do it. Again, in the Biblioteca de Colombina in Sevilla, Spain, he says, I'm coming to America, seize the holy city in Mount Zion. And now we have people today thinking that we're a myth. Well, they think Prester John is a myth. They think Khalifa is a myth. So he's looking for the Great Khan, presumably on this basis of Hebrew, perhaps Columbus. And his supporters had decided that the Great Khan, reported on by Marco Polo and others, might be the Israelite king who dwelt across the river from Prester John. And now we gather that Prester John is the Israelite king. But what river are we talking? This priest king is the Israelite king. Priest king, Prester John. John is a title. Priest is a title. He didn't call himself Prester John. He was called David. Nah, man. I don't think you understand, man. Love again to Uno for this PDF, man. The land of Prester John. Prester John lived in a tent throughout the vastness of his empire. He had no fixed abode, but perambulated his nomadic court according to the exigencies of politics or war. Lebna Dango Dewit. As you know in Hebrew, Dewit is David. Prester John is Lebna Dango Dewit. Was the young ruler's name as it figures in Ethiopian chronicles, but the Portuguese contemporary simplified it to David. David. King David. So again, we've come a long way. So, you know, now we're on part 18. And we can say, all right, what are our top three theories? You know, I'll give you mine. I won't hide them from you. My number one. That, you know, I'm building. You know, I don't need to convert nobody to my ideas. But when we're surfing and, you know, we get enough of these nuggets, man, to put a couple things together, I would see that it is a very strong thesis to make, a very strong, possibility. Based on our timelines, and I play the timelines, that this is the actual King David or the actual King Solomon. And that King David and Solomon was not in the BCs because there was no BC. There was no Christ. That was an invention to hijack you from your creator. Yes, you have a Messiah. You have a Moshe. You have a Messiah. Those who are messengers, those who are sent to literally save you out of captivity, but you never worship them. They only turn you to your creator. They are not the creator. And that is the new doctrine. And that's the difference between Nestorian Christians and Christians, is that Nestorian Christians do not believe that Jesus is God, nor that Mary is the mother of God. But the new doctrine through the councils, after the council, the Nicaea councils and all the other councils that follow, was that Jesus is God and Mary is the mother of God. And that's what separated these Nestorians from these traditional Christians today. So Prester John would be labeled a Nestorian, even though he's a David, a King David. Because there's no way that he believes that his Messiah, not Christ, but his Mashiach, right? Moses is God. That's crazy. So he would be a Nestorian to not believe that his Mashiach is God. See, That's how they play with their Nestorian and their hijack. But this is your Prester John, Epriste Juan, Emperor of the Abyssinios or Ethiopias. Again, America is a Ethiopia. It is a India. You talking about the Moors, man? This is a Morocco. Love again to Uno, man. And my man Isaac Ford had a great conversation about that. You know how this is West Africa, west of Africa, a colony of Morocco. But I don't enjoy being colonized by anybody when I am indigenous. So Letna Dango Duit was the young ruler's name as it figures in Ethiopian chronicles, but his Portuguese contemporaries simplified it to David. As for the fancy title bestowed on him by European imagination, that died hard. That died hard. All right, so the Moors and Abyssinians called him Emperor and not Prester John. The Moors and Abyssinians called him Emperor and not Prester John. El Prester Juan, Emperador de los Abyssinias, Emperor, King, not Prester John. So, you know, we're going on this investigation of Prester John, but the more and more we get it, he's not called, he's being called this, but this is not at all doing our elder any justice, our ancestor any justice by calling him Prester John, when a little recon will pull you and get his name of Lebna Dango DeWitt David. The Moors and Abyssinians called him Emperor and not Prester John. Albuquerque seems to have been the first person to take note of this fact, but Moors and Abyssinians notwithstanding, to the Portuguese, he had always been Prester John, and Prester John he would remain. So the hijack's gonna keep calling him Prester John. Okay. The emperor at this time was some 20 years of age. Old Queen Helena's tutelage was a thing of the past. The dowager still lived at court, but in retirement. Young David, we're talking about Prester John. Young David, like his namesake, an alleged ancestor. All right, so now they're linking him to an ancestor of David. All right. So with our timeline situation, we can link him right to being that. Or, you know, like I said, top three theories. One, he is King David, literally. Two, he is King Solomon, literally, because Solomon is still a David. Every son of David is a son of David. David is a title being passed on. So Solomon is still a David. Or theory number three, he's a descendant of King David, literally of the lineage and of the line of the kings of Jerusalem, and was recently taken down in either the 12, 13, or 14, you know, 1400s. And that when Columbus said he's coming here to conquer the holy city in Mount Zion, this is the kingdom they took down with the papal bull Dum Diversus, 1452, subjugate their kingdom, their empire, take it all. Enemies of Christ. They did not rock the hijack. Young David, like his namesake, an alleged ancestor, had embarked early on a military career. And it goes into this Lebna Dango. And again, we're just talking about this great Khan. Columbus looking for this great Khan. All right, so he has this Hebrew interpreter. Perhaps Columbus and his supporters had decided that the great Khan, reported on by Marco Polo and others, might be the Israelite king who dwelt across the river from Prester John. So regardless if Prester John is the Israelite king they're talking about, as we hear about the 10 tribes being in exile at the same time, so they got their own king, and certain kings were still paying tribute to Prester John. Even in his letters, he say that 72 kings were paying tribute unto him. So if he's the king of Judah, then yes, the other tribes will be paying tribute unto him. I mean, his kingdom sounded like Eden, right? When we read that letter in 1165, you know, allegedly, you know what I'm saying, by this King David, which is this Prester John. All right, so, but either way, we're talking about the Great Khan being in America, reported on by Marco Polo and others, might be the Israelite king. So either way, there is an Israelite king here, people. Either way, with this author, Ronald Sanders and Lost Tribes and Promised Lands, is letting us know there is an Israelite king that Columbus knew about and brought a Hebrew interpreter to have this, you know, encounter, have this to be the mouthpiece for this encounter of Israelites here. Not just some scattered, oh, that's the tribe of Gad. No, the kingdom, the whole pie. This America is sandwiched by two enormous sunken continents. So, Egypt being here and all the OG history that's going on right here makes perfect sense when you look at the orientation of the Americas. And for them just to get to this mystical place, and for Columbus himself to say that the Orinoco River flowing out of South America must be connected to the terrestrial paradise or Eden, that he's claiming Eden is here, and now we have the other substantiating evidence that he knows that the Israelite king is here, and we're connecting that to King David himself. So, you know, that's how we started this. Now, I want to back up a little bit. You know, we're just doing a quick recap. And then we're going to get some tremendous, you know, food for our quest. Let's continue our quest. Okay. So, again, we're just talking about the Israelite king. Now, in fact, the Prester John letter, we just talked about the letter, may at least in part have Jewish roots. So we're only talking about Israelites. Israelite roots. In the desert that separates the mountains from the sandy sea, the writer tells us an underground rivulet turns into a large river in which an abundance of precious stones is to be found. Let me back up a little bit. I ain't even ready for that yet. Let's just go here. Despite such miracles of nature, the main feature of the landscape in Prester John's realm, so the kingdom of King David, Lebna Dangle Dewit, seems to be desert. It is dominated by a waterless sandy sea. Now we're going to get into, you know, we got into that San Manyan. We're going to get a little bit more into it. It's going to be beautiful. Beautiful, I tell you. It is dominated by a waterless sandy sea on which the sand moves and swells into waves like the sea and is never still. This might sound crazy until you start YouTubing sand rivers. All right. After a desert journey of 3 days from this sea, one reaches mountains from which descends a waterless river of stones, which flows through our country to the sandy sea. 3 days in the week it flows and casts up stones, both great and small, and also carries with it wood to the sandy sea. When the river reaches the sea, the stones and wood disappear and are not seen again. While the river is in motion, it is impossible to cross. On the other 4 days, it cannot be crossed. The desert character of the rim is further suggested by John's particular stress upon elephants, dromedaries, and camels among the many animals to be found there. Yet for all this aridity, there is abundance. The Sandy Sea, for example, contains all kinds of edible fish. Yeah, man. You got a sea, a sandy sea with precious stones that has edible fish that apparently is magnificent to taste, according to the letter of Prester John. Now, where then is this remarkable country? Our magnificence, writes Prester John, dominates the three Indias and extends to the farther Indias. So we got some of this before. We're just doing a quick recap where the body of St. Thomas and the Apostle rests. It reaches the desert toward the place of the rising of the sun and continues through the valley of deserted Babylon close to the Tower of Babel. Now, keep that Babylon in mind because we're going to go back to it. Suddenly, the vague immensity takes on a biblical tinge. So now we're just talking, it feels like the Old Testament. All right, now, again, Columbus is over here looking for Prester John. He says this Israelite king is across the river from Prester John. And now we're hearing about this Sand River. All right, so when you get across the river from Prester John, now you know they're just talking about the Sambatyon River, the Sand River, in which, you know, according to, you know, a few different sources talks about the exile of the 10 tribes and how this river encircled them, this Sand River encircled them. Now they called it the Sabbath River. They said it ran, you know, through 6 days and then didn't run on the Sabbath, rested on the Sabbath, and the tribes couldn't cross it because they had to rest on the Sabbath. And you can't cross the Sabbath River on the Sabbath. It won't be good for you. So that river kept them in exile, but they can still see, you know, from across the river, they can still see Prester John and his kingdom, and Prester John can still see them, so they can still communicate. So Prester John can still communicate with the exiled 10 tribes that were across the river. That's why he probably said the Israelite king across the river from Prester John, who was also an Israelite king, but he's the emperor. And then you have the other king of the 10 tribes, right? So you have a northern and southern kingdom. Where then is this remarkable country? Our magnificence rise. Prester John dominates the three Indias. They call you Indians for a reason, and extends to farther India. Columbus was looking for India. Which one? Which one? Did he find it? Which one? Where the body of the Saint Thomas the Apostle rests. It reaches through the desert towards the place of the rising sun. It continues to the valley of the deserted Babylon, close to the Tower of Babel. Suddenly, the vague immensity takes on a biblical tinge. This is deepened when John informs us that his territories comprise the Pisan, which is one of the four rivers that rise up out of the terrestrial paradise, according to the second chapter of Genesis. So again, we're talking Eden. Columbus mentioned the Orinoco River connecting to the terrestrial paradise. Now we're hearing this, you know, other, you know, river here in this terrestrial paradise, according to the second chapter of Genesis. Furthermore, like the land of Hivala around the biblical Pisan, flows John's country, contains gold and onyx. It also flows with milk and honey. Wow. So Prester John's kingdom flows with milk and honey. I mean, how close is he to Eden? And did a black man discover the fountain of youth? So, yeah, we got this article before, but it just lays out the connection between Prester John and the fountain of youth. You know, back to the Marco Polo situation that we're going to get into today. Did a black man discover the fountain of youth? So, if Prester John did, he's about 30-something today. He did. So, we're just talking King David. Remember, King David's supposed to return and reign. It's not going to be any strife over who's king of Israel when King David returns. And if he has the fountain of youth, and if he's Prester John, then he's already here. Does it not connect with you, this David? The Moors and Abyssinians called him emperor, not Prester John. Levna dangled the wheat. So we're just talking about the three Indias. All right. Furthermore, let's get here. So we got the milk and honey. A hint at the location of this realm is provided by Genesis 2:13, which tells us that another of the four rivers of Eden, the Gihon, compasseth the whole land of Ethiopia. Which one? There's multiple Ethiopias, east and west. They called you Ethiopians here. Samuel Seawall called you Ethiopians here. John tells us that the palace is in Susa, the ancient capital of Persia, but this also implied proximity to Ethiopia in the vague geographical imagination of medieval Europe. As the centuries passed, the continental rim of Prester John's letter, clearly somewhat south of the original Tartar center of the legend, was to be increasingly identified as Ethiopia. But then they ended up back, you know, looking for it over there. And then they started looking for it over here. The Zoroaster-like character, who thus begins to emerge, can be perceived as deeply bound up in the imagery and mythology of the ancient East. In some ways, he's another version of the noble non-European, whose Western counterpart we have come upon in the Fortunate Islands. But there's a significant difference. Unlike the Fortunate Islander, this sophisticated Oriental knows both the value of money and the necessities of war. The Western idea was founded in a classical simplicity and closeness to a fresh and fertile nature, whereas this Oriental one reposes in a natural environment that is harsh, forbidding, and old, and that yields up minerals and miracles more readily than vegetation. The way of life envisioned for the West, was essentially democratic. This Eastern one is the best of all possible monarchies. The Fortunate Islands beckon to pioneers, Prester John's domains to pilgrims and saints, while the noble savage sings of a future far from the clutter of decadent civilization. Our noble Ethiopian makes a plea for the treasures, both material and spiritual, that may still be found among the rubble of sacred past. He represents a kind of archaeological rediscovery, a digging up of Hellenistic Christians' origins in the East. Oh yeah, the origins are the line, your seed, the actual line of David, the actual line of Moses. Not their, you know, spinoff, their hijack of your energy that they're calling this Christianity, when giving you a new testament. The Most High said, your new covenant comes with a whole new energy. And they act like it happened. Here's your new testament. Here it goes. You're looking for it, right? The Prester John legend thus emerges as a Christian counterpart to those visions of a long foreign ancient East that we have glimpsed among Jews, Muslims and Jews on the Iberian Peninsula. Indeed, it represents an assertion for Europe in general of that tolerant spirit represented above all by medieval Spain and acceptance of that East and some of its culture and racial complexity. In fact, Prester John's letter may in part have Jewish roots. All right, then we're going to get into the San Bignan right quick. We said the three Indians again, and we got this before. Let's get a little bigger. When we get into the small print, we get the three Indias. Alright, the exploits of the Apostle Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew in each of the three Indias. This later concept became a standard one in the Middle Ages. One of the three Indias faced Ethiopia. So here's your breakdown of the three Indias. And you are in one of them. One faced Ethiopia, according to Pseudo-Abdias. The second faced Persia. And the third occupied the ends of the earth between the ocean and the rim of darkness. The ends of the earth. Well, Columbus, you know, remember they thought they were going to fall off? The ends of the earth. So you're in the ends of the earth to them. You're in the ends of the earth. So the third India occupied the ends of the earth between the ocean and the rim of darkness. The third India became especially fruitful for geographical imagination. Eden, the realm of untold islands, California, Califia, in which the plural term Indias, etymologically one and the same as Indies, came to rest for once and for all. So, Indias or Indies, Prester John of the Indies. Indians, they also have Prester John of the Indians. I've seen it like that as well. So, and again, we're talking about Ethiopia being a general term. This small print right here says there were also less mysterious, more valid definitions of the three Indias among medieval geographers. But for most Europeans, even learned ones, even the smart ones, even smart Europeans. So for most Europeans, even learned ones, the term covered a vast and distant region of dark-skinned peoples. So Indians only covered a vast, distant region of dark-skinned people, culminating in a countless array of islands in one direction, and in Ethiopia, the biblical Cush, in the other. So we have islands in one direction, and then what they're calling the biblical Cush over there in so-called Africa. All right, so you have one direction Africa, the other direction Americas, both of them being Indias, both of them being Ethiopias. So, Prester John of the Three Indies. Now let's get to this river. In fact, the Prester John letter may, at least in part, have Jewish roots. Israelite roots. In the desert that separates the mountains from the sandy sea, the writer tells us of an underground rivulet turns into a large river in which an abundance of precious stones is to be found. Now beyond this river, he goes on, are 10 tribes of Jews. Okay, so we've got the 10 tribes. Right, so we have northern and southern Israel, who, though they pretend to have their own kings, are nevertheless our servants and tributaries. And I ask you, as the king of Judah, as King David, or as King Solomon, are not the kings or those pretending kings of the southern tribes tribute unto them? Do not the southern tribes, the 10 tribes, pay tribute unto the king of Jerusalem, the king of Judah, the king David? Are nevertheless our servants and tributaries. Nothing more on the subject is said in the original version of the letter, but then they have a later one, which seems like it could be more of a hijack. Let's see. But it is noteworthy that in an embroidered version produced by later generations, this passage is among the ones that underwent the greatest amplification. So someone seriously amped this shit up later on. Could it be a hijack? Let's see. So in 1507, there was an English version that said the weak kings of the above passage, or said, or this, Sanders is saying that the weak kings of the above passage became, quote unquote, a great king of Israel, whom Prester John concedes to be twice as strong as I am. So now in the later version, all right, so in the original version, these 10 tribes are servants and paying tributary to this King David or Prester John. In the later 1507 version, there's a great king of Israel who they're saying Prester John is quoting as saying is twice as strong as he is. His dominions are twice as great as all of Christendom in Turkey. And he hath under him 300 kings, 4,000 princes and dukes and earls and barons and knights and squires without number. So it got amped up. This was the most amplified. So now this makes Prester John look small. There's somebody twice as big as him suddenly. But the funny thing is that even in the hijack, they're still acknowledging that there is a great Israelite king here. That since Columbus is looking for this Prester John here, he's bringing a Hebrew interpreter. There's a river that separates this Israelite king. So now this is the Israelite king that was being talked about later as the Israelite king that lives across the river from Prester John. They're using the hijack version. That's what it felt like, right? To say that there's an Israelite king who's greater than Prester John across the river. What river? The Sand River. What river? The San Manyan River, right? The Sandy Sea. The Sand River. Alright. So now this becomes, you know, this other thing. So very interesting how the plan is. Alright, so let's go. Indeed, it is very likely that some sort of identification between Prester John and the King of Israel. Alright, so we know Prester John is the King of Israel or Judah, but maybe they're calling him the King of Israel, and this is King David, the King of Judah, straight up. So you have a King of Judah and a King of Israel, right? Between the remote realm of Christians and final refuge of the 10 lost tribes lies buried in various sources of this legend. This possibility seems very close to the surface in the early Central Asian version provided by Hugh of Jobala, with his intimations of Tartars and the King of the Khazars. Only a generation after Bishop Hugh, the celebrated Jewish traveler Benjamin of Tudela describes a relationship he had heard between four of the lost tribes and a nomadic group called Kofar al-Turuq. Kofar al-Turuq on the Central Asian steppes. So he's talking about Benjamin Tudela. So we're gonna get into some of this Tudela. I've been meaning to do it. So he's describing the relationship that he heard between four of the lost tribes and a nomadic people called Kofar al-Turuq on the Central Asian steppes. The Kofar al-Turuq eventually were not Christians, but their purported relationship with some of the lost tribes resembles that of Prester John, and could have had something to do with the making of the latter's legend. So this Kofar al-Turuq, you know, we're going to have to definitely dig on this, because this author is saying that this seems to resemble Prester John's people, and they are in cahoots with these lost tribes here. But of course, these are not just nomadic people, if it's Prester John's people. And that, you know, is what we're bringing to the table based on our own research. Alright, so, but the most probable Jewish source for the Prester John's letter that we know of is the narrative of a curious figure of Jewish history, Eldad the Danite, making his appearance toward the end of the 9th century. Alright. Let me get the rest of this. This looks pretty good. This looks pretty good. Eldad the Danite, man, we gotta dig on that. All right. Making his appearance toward the end of the 9th century, Eldad traveled through Mesopotamia, North Africa, Spain, sojourning with the Jewish communities in these places and telling them of astounding story that their rabbis and scholars took quite seriously. He said he was a member of the tribe of Dan, which was now living with three of the lost tribes beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. Dan had left the kingdom of Israel long before the conquest of the Assyrians and what they're calling 722 BC. Alright, what they're calling 722 BC. But it had refused to participate in Jeroboam's revolt against Solomon's son Rehoboam and had gone into exile instead. The Danites had thought at first of going to Egypt, but it was forbidden them to return to the scene of their ancient servitude. So let's just get this right quick. I just want to jump right into Benjamin of Tudela. Let's get into this Benjamin of Tallulah right quick, right fast. See if I can get this any bigger. All right, cool. Let's just get it. Let's just rock. Oh, yeah, you feel my heartbeat back there. Because something feels like it's about to go down in the investigation of Preston John, man. Hope everybody's staying hijack free, being creative and digging on it. I had to take a nice stretch because we're about to get busy. Let's go. So they're going to take us to Baghdad. All right, let's just flow with it. In Baghdad, there are about 40,000 Jews, and they dwell and security and prosperity and honor under the great caliph, and amongst them are all great sages, the heads of academies engaged in the study of the law. In this city, there are 10 academies. At the head of the great academy is the chief rabbi R. Samuel, the son of Eli. He is the head over the academy Goan Jacob. He is a Levite and traces his pedigree back to Moses, our teacher. The head of the second academy is R. Hanania. All right, let me just skip ahead. We're going to go into a couple things. All right, so let's go ahead. And at the head of them all is Daniel, the son of Hizdai, who is styled our Lord, the head of the captivity of Israel. He possesses a book. And again, this is the itinerary of Benjamin Tallulah, right? By Benjamin of Tallulah. Right? So they're calling the Daniel, son of Hizdai, our Lord, the head of the captivity of Israel. He possesses a book of pedigrees. He possesses a book of pedigrees going back as far as David, king of Israel. So we're still talking Preston John. We're still talking David. The Jews call him our Lord, head of captivity. Okay. And the Mohammedans call him Sadnai ben Daud, and has been invested with authority over all the congregations of Israel at the hands of Emir al-Mu'minin, the Lord of Islam. Let's just go. I mean, some of y'all already are getting this. I wish I had time to get all the small print. I'll try to get some of it. But remember, we talked about these exilarchs, you know what I'm saying? The head of Jerusalem, which they're calling the head of captivity, right? But we're just talking about the kings of Jerusalem. The first line of exilarchs, which ended with Hezekiah in the year of 1040, traced their descent from David through Zerubbabel, his dies. All right, continue somewhere, but let's just go. Right, so for thus Muhammad commanded concerning him and his descendants, and he granted him a seal of office over all congregations that dwell under his rule, and ordered that everyone, whether Muhammadan or Jew, or belonging to any other nation in his dominion, shall rise up before him, the exilarch, and salute him, and that anyone who should refuse to rise up should receive 100 stripes. It must be some, you know, lashes or something, right? So after the fifth day, when he goes to pay a visit to the great caliph, horsemen, Gentiles, as well as Jews, escort him, and heralds proclaim him in advance, make way before our Lord, the son of David, as is due upon him, unto him. The Arabic words being, Amelu Tariq La Satna Ben Daud. So they're just doing all this for David, right? Doing all this with David. He is mounted on a horse and is attired in robes of silk and embroidery, with a large turban on his head. From the turban is suspended a long white cloth adorned with a chain upon which the cipher of Muhammad is engraved. Then he appears before the caliph and kisses the hand, and the caliph rises and places him on a throne which Muhammad had ordered to be made for him. And all the Muhammadan princes who attend the court of the caliphs rise up before him. So this is during the Babylonian captivity. Now, do you or do you not remember our exilarchs? Exilarch David. That's where we got it from. And then we looked at the definition and said these were the heads or the kings of Jerusalem during the time of captivity in Babylon. So we got Babylon and Georgia. All right, you can trace all this back to King George. You can trace all this back. You know what I'm saying? We might get some more of it. You know, we've done it before. We got the Raja Haraja. We got the Pandian. All right. Exilarch, brother of Solomon, father of Hasdai. Let's just go back right quick. You know, so we see our exilarchs. We see how we rocking. We see we're just talking about Raja Hiraja, Chola the Second. We're talking about Jadaron, emperor of Soli, Prester John. All right. We're only talking about Prester John. And again, he's being called David. David, David, David. You know, haven't got to the bottom of what this Sauslin means. If y'all know, let me know. But we're just talking about the Exilarch Davids during the Babylonian captivity. We just talked about Hezdai. His died, and at the head of them all is Daniel, the son of his died. So if Daniel is the son of his died, and this David is father of Exilarch his died during the Babylonian captivity. Daniel is the son of his dad. Then that would make Daniel what? According, I mean, you know, let me, I'm surfing the wave with you. The grandson of this David? Because this David is the father of his dad and his dad, and Daniel is the son of his dad. I mean, are we rocking on the same, you know? Are we together with this? Now, they say the estimated birth date is 1302. So, if Daniel would be the grandson of him, that's after 1302. Whoa. I mean, I think I'm seeing, but y'all let me know. Maybe I'm just going crazy. You know what I mean? The Jews call him our Lord, head of captivity. And at the head of them all is Daniel, the son of Hizdai, who is styled our Lord, the head of captivity of all Israel. King David, Prester John, father of Hizdai, Hasdai. All right. Is it the same? Is it something else? All right. Let's just go. Let's just go. Let's just go. Before I go crazy. Before I go crazy. Alright. We'll work. But again, we're just talking about the Exilarchs. We're going to get back in this because as you see, it gets interesting really, really fast. Really, really, really fast. Let's get some more of this right quick. Alright. Okay. Let's jump back into it. this is good. Let me get it. So he's mounted on a horse. It's David, right? And it's attired in robes of silk and embroidery, large turban. All right, so we got that. Then he appears before the caliph and kisses his hand. The caliph rises and places him on a throne, which Muhammad had ordered to be made for him. And all the Muhammadan princes who attended the court of the caliph rise up before him. And the head of captivity is seated on the throne opposite to the caliph in compliance with the command of Muhammad to give effect to what is written in the law. We're just talking about the law. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from beneath his feet until he come to Shiloh, and to him shall the gathering of the people be. So they're still recognizing the law even in Babylonian captivity. Interesting. Interesting, Benjamin of Tudela. The authority of the head of the captivity extends over all the communities of Shinar, Persia, Khorasan, and Sheba, which is El Yemen, and Dayar Kala, and the land of Aram Naharam, Mesopotamia. So the authority of the head of captivity, or this King David, or this Prester John, extends all this place. So he's still being treated as emperor, even in Babylonian captivity, even during this time. He still, you know, is being, you know, raised up. Now this is, you know, all right. And over, he's still got authority over the dwellers in the mountains of Ararat and the land of the Alans. That's very interesting as it ties to Georgia and these Israelites, right? Which is a land surrounded by mountains and has no outlet except by the iron gates which Alexander made, but which were afterwards broken. Here are the people called Alani from the Alans. His authority extends over the land of Siberia and the communities in the land of Targum unto the mountains of Asve and the land of Gergen, and the inhabitants of which are so called Gerganium, who dwell by the river Gihon. And these are the Gergeshites, who follow the Christian religion, or Nestor Christian religion. Further, it extends to the gates of Samarkand. We're still talking about the authority. The authority that this head of captivity, this exilarch, this King David had, even during the Babylonian captivity, when the 10 tribes were surrounded and encompassed by that Sabbath River that we're going to get some more into, you know what I mean? He's across from that, and still, as a king of Judah, is a royal line now. What does it say in the small print? A nephew David became exilarch. Let's go back up. The first line of exilarch, which extend from Hezekiah in the year of 1040, traced their descendant from David through Zerubbabel, his dies. His dies pedigree was through Hillel, who sprang from a female branch of the royal line. Which is interesting, because when we get into the Raja Herajas, when you follow this David Salzman, they say he's also, you know, extending from, I think, a nephew of Queen Tamar. So we're going to get that Tamar, because we got that before, and I told you that that's going to link right back in the Crest of John. All right. Okay, so all connected, you know. Nephew David became exilarch jointly with R. Samuel, the head of the great academy. I don't know exactly how that plays, so if y'all know what that means, head of the great academy, whose authority over all the communities in Asia became paramount. All the communities in Asia. So now you got the, you know what I'm saying, those maps that show, you know, Tartar or land, emperor of you know, Cham and Khan and this and all this kind of stuff. You know, that's Khan, Prester John, emperor, Land of Prester John, all that stuff became all these communities in Asia. That's why Prester John is on those maps. Samuel had an only daughter who was learned in the scriptures and the Talmud. She gave instructions through a window remaining in the house while the disciples were below, unable to hear. Okay, I don't know what they're getting at. The office of exarch had not recently been revived, had not but recently been revived, and Muhammad, here referred to, may have been Muhammad El Mat Maktafi, the Caliph Mastanshed's predecessor. Mastanshed's, right? The Alans throughout the Middle Ages occupied Georgia, and the regions of the Caucasus as to the Iron Gates, which Alexander made. Yule is commenting on Marco Polo's text. So the Alans throughout the Middle Ages occupied Georgia. How does that refer to King George? How does that refer to the kings of Jerusalem? And why are they over here? And why is Columbus bringing a Hebrew interpreter over here looking for the Great Khan? Wan Khan. Prester John. Why is everybody looking for Prester John? We're gonna get into this voided manuscript. I know you see it keep popping up, but remember, this is the manuscript that cannot be deciphered. Right? Cannot be deciphered. And just right here, it says the identification of several of the plants as New World specimens. So they were identifying these plants in this indecipherable situation. I mean, they had all kind of pictures of, people bathing and stuff. I mean, I don't know if they're in a tube, these people being created in some type of tube or tunnel, man. I don't know what's going on here, but they got these plants though. And, throughout, some are linking this directly to the identification of several of these plants as New World. This is the New World. So they're identifying these plants in the Voynich manuscript as American, brought back to Europe by Columbus. Body bag. So, just in case you thought it was play-play, just in case you thought it was play-play, when we're talking about Prester John and we're referring to, Columbus bringing the interpreter and all that. Just in case you thought it was play play. Just in case you thought it was play play. Hold up, hold up. Moving too fast, moving too fast. Slow down, there we go. Just in case you thought it was play play, the identification of several of the plants as New World specimens brought back to Europe by Columbus indicates that the manuscript could not have been written before 1493. Could not have been written before 1493. Or does it simply indicate that Prester John's in America, man? And if it happened, if it didn't happen before 1493, and we got scholars and researchers pointing this directly and saying Prester John himself did this, that this is King David's code and they cannot crack the code. Scientific or magical text in an unidentified language and cipher, apparently based on Roman minuscule characteristics. Apparently, they don't know. The text is believed by some scholars to be the work of who they're calling Roger Bacon. Bacon, since the themes of illustration seems to be representing topics known to have his interest of Bacon. All right, that's funny, right? Because we got our drop right here. This is the drop that it was actually deleted, and someone else had copied just the page that I needed on another blog, man. So love to frankenland.blogspot, man. Dope. So this Jadaron, right? Jadaron. Jadaron, Raja Haraja Chola II, Jadaron, Emperor of Soli, Prester John the Pandian. Okay, Jadaron. So this Jadaron, Prester John, was the legendary Jewish Christian king. They won't just call him an Israelite king. He has to be a Jewish Christian king. Emperor called Prester John. So let's just call him King David. So this King David. All right, so Jadaron was a legendary Jewish Christian king, Israelite king called Prester John. And he abdicated the throne in 1174. So he abandoned this throne in 1178 in favor of his brother so that he could become a, what they're calling, Christian hermit monk. But I like that term monk, because then we have to think about Monk's Mounds, Cholula, Monk's Mounds. Think about the Monk Mounds. And think about what they're calling a hermit monk and how he left his throne to become a monk. He was famous for his beautiful gardens and wrote a book on plants in Hebraeo-Georgian Ossetian language. Georgian Ossetian language. Alans. The Alans throughout the Middle Ages occupied Georgia. Georgia. Exilarch David, King David of Babylon during the Babylonian captivity. Exilarch during the Babylonian captivity and Georgia. He was famous for his beautiful gardens and wrote a book of plants on plants in the Hebrew. Georgian Ossetian language of his family. This book is today called the Voynich Manuscript. Body bag. So this ain't no Robert Bacon doing this shit. This is 12th century work. And if it wasn't 12th century, if it was after the 1400s, if it was in the 1500s, man, then you got a King David or a lineage of King David in the 1500s. Fully alive, and that is the kingdom, your kingdom, they took down. Jadaron married his first wife, the Gebereh, lady of the Davidic house, Hannah, the daughter of the Babylonian exarch, his die. The fifth. Then Jadaron married secondly to a Pandian Indian princess. David Slauson was their eldest son. David Slauson was their eldest son. Alright, so this David Slauson is David Slauson the sixth. So which David Slauson, you know what I'm saying? Well, one of them is their oldest son, but you see, we're all talking about the same family here. All we gotta do is put this shit in order. Separate this David the sixth from David the fourth and second and the first. And this is Raja Hare Raja the second, Jadaron, Prester John. Father of Hasdai, the sixth of Babylon. Okay, so you see how it's all coming together here. Now I want to get back to where I was before I get too far out. All right, so let's just keep going right here with the Benjamin of Tadula. All right, further it extends to the gates of Samarra. Sorry, so we're still talking about, you know, all the extent of this David's kingdom here. Let me skip down. So remember Alexander, how we connected this Alexander. So you're going to keep hearing about Alexander's expeditions. Benjamin and Marco Polo both record the general belief current at the time of the Pass of Durban was traversed by Alexander. It is still called Turkish Demis Kapi, or the Iron Gate, and the Persians designated Sadi Iskandar, the Rampart of Alexander. And again, we have sources calling Prester John Alexander as well. Again, another title. Proves conclusively that the pass through which Alexander's army marched when pursuing Darius after the Battle of Arbela could not have been at Durban. Arian, the historian of Alexander's expeditions, writes that this pass was one day's journey from Rages. All right, so we're going to go into that. It'll go to that. It'll go to that. Now, in Baghdad, here we go, there are 28 Jewish synagogues, they say. All right, situated either in the city itself or Al-Karth in the other side of the Tigris, for the river divides the metropolis into two parts. The great synagogue at the head of the captivity, King David, has columns of marble in various colors overlaid with silver and gold, and on these columns are sentences of the Psalms in golden letters, and in front of the ark are about 10 steps of marble. On the topmost step are the seats of the head of the captivity and the princes of the house of David. The house of David. The house of David. Letna Dangle de Wheat, simplified by the Portuguese to David. Moors and Abyssinians call him Prester John. Young David, like his namesake and alleged ancestor. Young David, we're just talking about David. House of David, the city of Baghdad, is 20 miles in circumference, situated in a land of psalms, or palms, gardens, and plantations, plants, gardens. He's known for gardens and plants, this source says. He wrote a book, this Jadaron, all right, Prester John, wrote a book, man. On plants in Hebrew, Georgian, Ossetian language. Plants, gardens, plants and gardens. I can't make this up, man. Alright, I did not play or plan this. I just pulled some links up and we rock. Situated in the land of palms, gardens and plantations, the like of which is not to be found in the whole land of Shinar, right? No, there's no land like Prester John's land. People come thither with merchandise from all lands. Wise men live there. Wise men, Nestorian, wise kings renowned for wise counsel. Old kings renowned, famous for wise counsel. Philosophers who know all manner of wisdom. Wisdom, man. Man. Come on, let's tie this together, y'all. This is part 18 of the investigation. All this is coming together. We're bringing all the old links out. We're taking it home, man. Taking it home, taking it to the house. Nestor. Nestorian Christian, right? Nestorus. Name for old king renowned for wise counsel. So when they called King David a Nestorian Christian, or when they call him a, a Jewish Christian. We're only talking about the old kings renowned for their wisdom. Wise men live there, philosophers who know all manners of wisdom, and magicians expert in all manners of witchcraft. Enoch, let's go. The incident said, all right. So let's stop right there. Now let's go back in this link. All right. So we're just talking back to the Voynich manuscript. Let's take it back. David Sauslin. So we're talking about David Sauslin. Exilarch David Sauslin. Babylon and Georgia. Babylonian captivity. I'm glad I found this link, man. So put it in. Y'all take it. Print it out, man. This thing might disappear like the other one. So let's dodge the hijack. They're going to bring up the Khazars. And that's just, you know, we're going to see how that fits into our grand scheme. Let's go. One of the greatest regnants, queens of Georgia was known as Queen Tamar. Now, this is the queen. This is the female line that they were saying king, you know, is coming out of, or what, you know, whatever they're calling it. So, you know, we'll see how this ties in to the actual King David or the descendant of David. One of the great regent or regnant queens of Georgia was known as Queen Tamar, or Tamara the Great of Georgia. I knew about this queen since I was a small boy, as my sister was called Tamar. Right, so this is the researcher talking. Right? Now, Queen Tamar belonged to the Bagratid dynasty that claimed to be of the descent from King David. Queen Tamar was married to a very interesting historical figure called David Slauson, who was the king of Ossetia. Or Alania, when he married Tamar. Very interesting historical figure, David Slauson, who was king of Ossetia or Alania when he married Tamar. Ossetia. This voidic manuscript was written in Hebraeo-Georgian Ossetian language. Allen, Georgia. All right. In my researches, I was to discover a very interesting origin of David Slauson. David Slauson was the grandson of the Ossetian king Aton Baragrutuni, who was a son of Prince David of Georgia, who fled with his father to Ossetia after the failure of his father, Prince Demetrius, to take the throne of Georgia. Prince Demetrius' father, King George, the first of Georgia. So King George is the first of Georgia. Was also the ancestor of Queen Tamar. George I was the son of Bagrat III, who was the grandson of another Tamar Brugantuni, who was a daughter of Bagrat II of Carl Cartley. They're saying in 976. And Abkhazia and Remsimi of Armenia, sister of Ashot III, as I have written elsewhere. All right, so this person is digging up some drop. All these names for us to dig on. Take your pick and go there, because you will find drop at this point, for sure. Historians have confused Bagrat II with his grandson Bagrat III, the son of Empress Judith and Georgius Tsul, when Gurgen Bagrat II's natural father died in 1008. It was the grandson Bagrat III who became the king of all Georgia, and his grandfather Bagrat II died soon after. Now, when we talk Georgia, remember, my people, we're only talking Russia. Remember, we're just talking about the Russian truth. The Russian truth. We're just talking about Rus. R-U-S, and when we talk Rus, remember, we're talking about the land of Rus. So when we talk about the kings of Georgia, we're talking about the land of Rus. This is the Pictland continuation. These are Rus. It shows that the Rus were part and parcel with the Franks in forming the Knights Templars. Whoa. So these same Rus, that's none other than Andrus, Clan Ross, Princess Tamar. From these offspring come kings Melisius and Princess Scotia of Egypt. Remember, Scotia is where Scotland's coming from. And she was the Pharaoh's daughter that married Moshe, King Hermon, and Princess Tamar, the great Tamar. Now they say married Khazar King David. So I don't know how they're, putting this Khazar in there. I don't know if we're trying to say that the original Khazars are not the Khazars we think are the Khazar, or what hijack they're putting in there. So that's to be, determined, in our research. But we're talking Tamar. We're linking Tamar. All right. With this Ross, Andros, Alexander the Great. all connected to the same Ross, Kings of Georgia, Prester John, and that's why they called him Alexander. Lady Andros of Cleancio Andrea of the ancient and noble house of Andrews Andreas, with the calling Ptolemy, Egypt, Greek, Iberian, Hebrews, whose family named the Andrews Island Greece, Agios, Andrea, Greek towns, British Isle of Man, Andrews Island, California, and Andrews Islands, Bahamas, is a relative of Magas, Alex Andros, who is Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great is an Andrews, and so is Prester John, as it relates to Princess Tamar and these six kings, which is Vikings. Vikings is six kings, Hyksos kings, shepherd kings. Look at your royalty, people. This is Rus and this is Georgia. And the house of Andreas from the race of St. Andrew and the kindred of the kings of Jerusalem. Bang. And that, like our last lesson, you know what I mean? We're only talking about the picks. We're only talking about the picks. So we're only talking about Tamar, right? So you got Prince David of Georgia, fled with his father to a city after the failure of his father. All right, so we got that. So this Bagratik princess Tamar married what they're saying, Khazar King David of Taman, and their son Georgiatsu Zenobius, who was also the king of the Khazars. How does this connect? What does it mean? Are they Khazars? Is this a different Khazar? Just like we got Mongol, and realize that Prester John is the emperor ruler of these Kariots, Mongol set. That's also being hidden as, you know, as King David, and they're calling them Mongols because they're whooping up on all the, you know, King Darius and Persia and all that. So King David of Taman was a grandson of Khazar Khagan and King Aaron via his daughter, Princess Zenobia. Princess Zenobia married the chief of Prince Mani of one of the Khazar ethnic or clan groups. And that's where it gets interesting with this Khazar. So Princess Zenobia married the chief or Prince Mani of one of the Khazar ethnic or clan groups. Tribe, all right. That came from the Siberian homeland of the Kumans. All right. They were the descendants of the king. Check it. They were the descendants of King Hosea, the last king of Israel. So is there something else to this Khazar situation that we don't know about? Or are they just fucking just pulling this shit out their ass? Maybe. I don't know. You tell me. And his warrior horsemen of the tribe of Manasseh, who fled into the east and eventually established a Manassite kingdom north of China. China plays. We're going to get back into China. Then they want to put a haplogroup on it. R1AZ93. All right. So David Sarsen was also a cousin of Queen Tamara. All right. Tamara. We're just talking about from these offspring come, you know, these princes and kings and King Herman and Princess Tamar and all that. So it's coming straight out of this, you know, the same family. Lost tribes. All connected, my people. All connected. Let's get back into our Raja and Raja Cholas. All right. So according to the Georgian Chronicles, all right, Berdukans. So, all right, let me get that back. David Sarsen was also a cousin of Queen Tamar through her Ossetian mother, Berdukan. Berdukan. According to the Georgia Chronicles, Berdukan's father was Kudan, king of Ossetia, and her mother, Garunduk, Duka. was the daughter of a Jewish Ethiopian princess. Jewish Ethiopian princess or Israelite princess. All right. And the Byzantine ambassador to Jerusalem. And Andronicus Kamotaros Doukas, doing my best. King Atone was married to an Indian princess, all right, whose father, all right, just from the Indies or Indias, or just Prester John's people, same thing, whose father was a Cholan emperor of three Indias, Chola, Raja Chola II, Jadaran, emperor of Soli, Saliman, Prester John, Pandian, Cholan Empire of the Three Indias, which we just got. We're in the furthest India at the ends of the earth. Their son, Prince Jadaran, which they say Yochanan, which is John, Prester John, was to reign as Cholan Emperor, Raja Hiraja Chola II. King Atan also had an interesting religious background, as his father, Prince David, was a Christian, which I'll guarantee they mean Nestorian Christian. Nestorius Christian, old king renowned for wise counsel. Nestorian Christian, all right? And his mother, a Ossetian Jewish lady, or a Hebrew Israelite, Hebrew. Jadaran was the legendary Jewish Christian king emperor called Prester John. So we just got that. So you just got how he just broke down in the Voynich manuscript. Now Jadaran married his first wife, Gavaret, lady of the Davidic house, Hannah, the daughter of the Babylonian exarch, his died the fifth. Jadaran married secondly to the Panian princess, David. Panian princess, David Slosling was their eldest son and the youngest brothers. And his youngest brothers, Solomon and Hanan, were the Jewish kings of Tehama and Telmas, mentioned by Benjamin of Tudela. We just got that in his travelogue of the first time. His half-brother by his father's second wife, Vikrama Pandian, the king of Pandian in India. So again, we got these Pandian tribes, the Pandians. All right, the Cholas, the Pandians. We got a little bit of that, but I definitely want to dig deeper. And you know what I'm saying, when it comes to this itinerary, let me just do it like this. Let me do it from the top. All right, we're getting there. You know, this is Prester John, so. You know, we got to uppercut this thing. We're getting close to our dismount, though. So, you know, put on your rain boots and get ready for this drop, if you know what I mean. Let me get my battery charged up. So we don't got no excuses this time. Okay. All right. Good, good. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. All right, so. This author had before mentioned this, what they call a nomadic group. It was either in this one or another text, but yeah, let's just get it right quick. So yeah, we'll get back into this, but I just want to pull it up right quick. This is in Benjamin Tudela. This is the tribe that, you know, was referred to as, you know, might be of a relation to this Prester John. I want to see where I got that out of. So we got so many links up, man. There we go. The Kfar al-Tariq eventually were not Christians, but their purported relation with some of the lost tribes resembles that of Prester John and could have had something to do with the making of the latter's legend. Alright. So Ronald Sanders is connecting this group of what they're calling nomads to the Kingdom of Prince John. And Benjamin Tadula goes into it a little bit. Let's get this page right here. Let's go back. All right. Now it was time for the ripening of the fruit, and they ate and consumed everything. No man came forth to them, but on the mountains they saw cities and many towers. Then the king commanded two of his servants to go and inquire of the people who lived in the mountains. Okay, here we go. And to cross the river, either in boats or by swimming. And so they searched and found a large bridge on which there were three towers, but the gates of the bridge was locked, and on the other side of the bridge was a great city. Then they shouted in the front of the bridge till a man came forth and asked them what they wanted and who they were. So they kept shouting at this bridge, trying to find the people who live in the mountain to cross this river. Somebody finally came out and said, "Who are you?" But they did not understand him till an interpreter came who understood their language. I wonder what language this is, since Columbus is bringing Hebrew interpreters. And when they asked him, they said, "We are the servants of the king of Persia." Okay. "And we have come to ask who you are and whom you serve." To which the other replied, "We are Jews. And we have no king and no Gentile prince, but a Jewish prince rules over us." Then they questioned him with regard to the infidels, the sons of Guz of the Kfar al-Tariq. And he answered, "Truly, they are in league with us. And he who seeks to do them harm seeks our harm." Then they went their way and told the king of Persia, who was much alarmed. So this king of Persia had beef with this group already. And he's asking, these Jews, these Jews is letting them know, these Israelites is telling them that they have an alliance with them. But clearly, they had issues with how they were already being dealt with by this particular group. And as you know, Prince John was notorious for dealing with these Persians and, any of these forces, so-called Muslim forces. So, and on a certain day, the Jews asked him to join combat with them, but he answered, "I am not come to fight you, but the Kfar al-Tariq." All right. So the Persian just wanted to fight these guys, my enemy. So this was enemies of the Persians. "And if you fight against me, I will avenge on you by killing all the Jews in my empire. So if y'all Jews fight against me to get to these people, I'm going to kill all the Jews in Persia, Babylon." How important were these people? Who are these people? "I know that you are stronger than I am in this place. And my army has come out of this great wilderness starving and athirst. Deal kindly with me and do not fight against me, but leave me to engage the Kfar al-Tariq, my enemy, and sell me also the provisions which I require for myself and my army." The Jews then took counsel together and resolved to propitiate the king on account of the Jews who were in exile in his empire. So they went with it so that their people don't get slaughtered in Persia. The king entered their land with his army and stayed there 15 days, and then showed him much honor. And they showed him much honor, and also sent a dispatch to the Kfar al-Tariq, their allies, reporting the matter to them. So they took him in, but they still told the homies about it. Right? Thereupon, the latter occupied the mountain passes in force with a large army composed of all those who dwelt in the desert. And when the king of Persia went forth to fight with them, they placed themselves in battle array against them. The Kfar al-Tariq army was victorious and slew many of the Persian hosts. Sounds like Prester John in there. And the king of Persia fled with only a few followers in his country. All right. So look at this. It says the incidents here in the small print. Let me get it bigger. About to make our dismount. The incidents here related are fully gone into by Dr. Nabir in the third of his valuable articles, Where Are the Ten Tribes? There can be little doubt that the Kafir Al-Tarat, a people belonging to the Tartar stock, right? Prester John, king of the Abyssinios, you know, king of the Tartars, king of all that shit. He ruled the Tartars. He ruled all that shit. So belonging to the Tartar stock are identical with the so-called subjects of Prester John. Bang! My people, I'm reading this for the absolute first time, so I'm kind of excited. That's pretty cool. I did not expect to just run right into the link between Kafir Al-Tarat and Prester John. Now that's dope. Of whom so much was heard in the Middle Ages, they defeated Sinjar in the year 1141. This was, however, more than 15 years prior to Benjamin's visit. To judge them from the above passage, where the allies of the Jews are described as infidels, the sons of Gus of the Kafir Al-Tarat, Benjamin seems to be to confound the Guzes with the Tartar. Oh man, hold up. With the Tartar hordes. Now the Guzes belong to the Seljuk clans or tribes. Seljuk clans who had become Mohammedans more than 100 years before, so they converted over to Islam, as many of us did at that time and now. And as such, Benjamin would never have styled them infidels. These Gehuzes waged war with Sinjar in 1153 when he was significantly defeated and eventually made prisoner. It is in this battle that Benjamin must have been in reference. All right. So we just talking. He said this Kafir Al-Tarat, a people of Tartar stock, so-called, are identified with the so-called subjects of Prester John. Right there in our face. Let's go. So we got this Voynich manuscript written right by Prester John. We're getting this Raja Hiraja Cholas. We see it right here, the identification of several of the plants as New World specimens brought back to Europe by Columbus indicates the manuscript could not have been written before 1493. You know what I mean? I don't see that as conclusive evidence of that. I just see that as conclusive evidence that this manuscript has to do with the New World or Old World or the Americas. And that's what we really need to know. What we really got to know. But great information on the Kafir Al-Tarat to rock. Somebody please dig some more up on that. Maybe this would be a good place to make a dismount here. I think we got about 10 minutes, all right? So I want to get a piece of this. Oh, man. And then, you know, I wanted to get deep into this San Banyan, man, and get into this exile, man. And remember when we talk Euphrates and you say, oh man, America, what are you talking about? It's the old world. And yada, 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 yada. You know what I'm saying? When you start yada, yada, it don't take much to dig up on it and understand that, you know, these captions, man, these old 1700 captions, advertisements, 1700. Does not exist anywhere in the world. It has been captured with great difficulty and cost in the River Euphrates in America. The River Euphrates in America. Look, this is their depiction of it. These are these tapir animals that, you know, this is what they were, you know, putting down and sending back to Europe when they were here. And they were on the River Euphrates in America. Rather, he paints a colorful gauche of several tapirs grazing peacefully in the waters of what is undoubtedly meant to be the river, Euphrates River in America. That is undoubtedly meant to be the Euphrates River in America. And we're only talking about the land of Prester John. Now, let's do our best to make a double dismount. Do it like this. All right, let's jump right into it. So we're just talking about, this is from Avigdor Shahan, a prolific writer, historian, educator, embarked on the greatest journey of his life, following the footsteps of the 10 lost tribes. The ensuing voyage culminated in a book, El Erehal Sambanyan, Toward the Sambanyan, which is half a history of tribes and half a travelogue. For the Shahan had a deeply personal impetus, as he explained. All right, so he's going to go into, you know, let's just get it. I was 8 years old, 1940s, when a teacher, traditional Jewish school, told us with a trembling voice about the exile of 10 tribes. Reuben, Simon, Zebulun, Issachar, Dan, Gad, Asher, Naphtali, Ephraim, Manasseh, by the kings of Assyria and their cruel soldiers. He described the formidable river they crossed in their wanderings, the Sambanyan, and the fearsome mountains of darkness behind which they disappeared. He told us about the great country where they had a life of freedom and liberty, the commanders of their armies alert and ready, their swords sparkling, and their legions ordered in columns behind their banners and flags. Hey. That very day, Shahan and two younger friends, Moshele and Lebele, set out themselves in search of the 10 tribes. They decided that nearby the Dniester River was in fact the Sambanyan. So look up this Dniester River, right? They undertook to leave Karmarov, but never got to cross even the limits of its Jewish quarter. All right, some large black dog scared them off. And where I want to get to, I'm going to go right to it. All right. Okay, so we're back into the Benjamin of Tudela. All right, so a lot of people reference this Benjamin of Tudela. The famous Jewish traveler Benjamin of Tudela came close, or so he thought, to finding the tribe somewhere in Asia. The 17th century Jesuit missionary and scholar Diego Andres Roca in 1607 to 1688, that was his term, was certain that the tribes were in South America. Body bag, man. So the 17th century Jesuit missionary and scholar Diego Andres Roca, all right, lived in the 1600s, was certain that the lost tribes, were in South America. Yeah. The Irish nobleman Lord Edward Kingsborough, all right, 1795-1837, lost his fortune looking for them in pre-Columbian Mexican art. He died age 42 in Dublin Debtor's Prison, but his passion left us with a codex of Mesoamerican art in 9 massive volumes. The Scots missionary Nicholas McLeod spent decades in Japan and Korea searching for the true Israelites and all that. All right, let's get to this. They skip pages on us, man. They be skipping pages on us sometimes. Oh, man, I really want to get that fine print. All right, but y'all see it right here. All right, so we're going to keep going. So the famous Jewish traveler Benjamin Tudela came close, they said, but Diego Andres Roca was certain that the tribes were in South America. And again, we have the Euphrates River in South America. In America, with Columbus at the Orinoco River running out of South America, was connected to the terrestrial paradise. All right. Now, when we're talking about this, what and where is the Sambanyan, the term Sambanyan, the Hellenized distortion version of Sabbath? So it was a Sabbath river that returned into Hebrew text, appears in conjunction with the 10 lost tribes with striking frequency in Jewish folklore and imagination, as Avigdor Shahan's testimony. powerfully attest, same person, Samignon plays the role of Azareth. This is for Teach Me to Be Priestly, man. Love to teach. I know you're going to have a field day with this one. This is our dismount right here, people. According to Jewish folklore and imagination, as Avigdor Shadchan's testimony powerfully attests, Sabanyan, the Sabbath River, plays the role of Azareth, the place that must be reached, found, and crossed. At some point, the Euphrates ceased to be simply the Euphrates and became instead, as it sneaked into Edris's vision, simply the river. The river. So the Euphrates then became in Edris's vision just simply the river. All right, we're just talking about the role of Azareth, the cedar. The cedar, the place of cedar, the place of reeds. Also clear is that Josephus is beyond Euphrates. Look that up, beyond Euphrates by Josephus, refers not so much to the actual river Euphrates instead itself, but to a larger and ontologically deeper place than the actual terrain on the river's far banks. Just as the 10 tribes' place of exile becomes ever more removed, the literal marker that initially separated it takes on a more elaborate significance. The Samignon becomes the river mentioned in Esdras, which God, the creator, halted when the 10 tribes crossed over, which he will break into 7 channels when they come back. Whoa! The Samignon marks the edge of the world. Nabier aptly comments that the river itself is as mysterious as the existence of the 10 tribes. It would be lost time to trouble ourselves with the identification of the stream, but the Samignon, like Azareth, has allowed for endless speculation. Virtually every river on earth from Yangtze to the Amazon has at some point been identified as the real Samignon. Samignon appears at times as a river and others simply as a place name. So it could be a river or a place name, Azareth. Simply there is ambiguity about its function with regard to the 10 tribes exile. In some passages we read that the tribes were exiled beyond Samignon. In others we find them exiled to Samignon. A third instance posits that one exile went beyond Samignon while another went to it. A locative Samignon appears in many passages in rabbinic literature when Samignon, not only the river separating the 10 tribes from the rest of the world, but also the site to which they were exiled. The rabbinic literature, the latter Midrash in particular, speaks explicitly of Samignon as a place of concealment and separation, concealment and protection. This is true not only for the 10 lost tribes, the first group to be admitted to Samignon, but also for all sorts of people who are concealed and remained in a protected state. This has been part 18 of the investigation of your brother, my brother, your elder, my elder, Prester John, also known as King David, Raja Heraja, Chola II, Jadaran, Emperor of Soli, Prester John, the Pandian. We're only talking about Lebnadengo Duit, the young ruler, David, but by the Moors and Abyssinians called Emperor. I love y'all. Stay up, suit up, and choose up, and stay hijack free. You dig?